A summary of the 34 suttas. Division 1. The moralities. Number 1. Brahmajala Sutta. The supreme net. What is the teaching is not. The monks observe the wanderer superior arguing with his pupil about the merits of the Buddha, his doctrine, the Dhamma and the order, the Sangha. The Buddha tells them not to be affected by either praise or blame of the teaching, and declares that worldling will praise him for superficial reasons and not for the essence of his teaching. He lists 62 different types of wrongdoing, all of which are based on conduct of six sense base and their objects. Contact conditions craving, which in turn leads to clinging, to re-becoming, to rebirth, to aging and death and all manner of suffering. But Tathagata, the Buddha, has gone beyond these things, and all 62 wrong views are trapped in his net. Number 2. Samanyapala Sutta. The fruits of homeless life. King Ajasata of Magadha, who gained the throne by parricide, comes to the Buddha with a question he has already posed in vain to six rival philosophers. What are the fruits visible here and now in this life? Of the life of renunciation, the Buddha tells him and then goes on to speak of the higher benefits, the various meditative status and finally true liberation. The king, deeply impressed, declares himself a lay follower. The Buddha later tells his disciples that but for his crime, Ajasattu would have become a stream winner by the opening of the Dhamma eye. Number 3. Ambatta Sutta. About Ambatta, pride humbled. Pokkurusati, a famous Brahmin teacher, sends his pupil Ambatta, supposedly fully trained in Brahmin law, to find out if Asati Gautama is the great man he is alleged to be, and if therefore he bears the 32 marks of great man. Ambatta, proud of his Brahmin birth, behaves stupidly and arrogantly towards the Buddha, and thereupon learns a thing or two about his own ancestry, besides being made to realize that the Khatriyas, the warrior's noble caste, are superior to the Brahmins. Humbled, he returns to Pokkurusati, who is furious at his conduct. Hastened to see the Buddha, learns that he does indeed bear the 32 marks and becomes a convert. Number 4. Sonadanda Sutta. About Sonadanda, qualities of a true Brahmin. The Brahmin Sonadanda of Champa learns of the ascetic Gautama's arrival and goes to see him against the advice of other Brahmins who think it beneath his dignity. The Buddha asks him about the qualities of the true Brahmin. He mentioned 5, but the Buddha's instance admits that these can be reduced to 2, wisdom and morality. He becomes a convert but does not experience the opening of the Dhamma eye. Number 5. Kutadanta Sutta. About Kutadanta, a bloodless sacrifice. The Brahmin Kutadanta wants to hold a great sacrifice with the slaughter of many hundreds of beasts. He appeals, improbably as Rhys Davis points out, to the Buddha for advice on how to do this. The Buddha tells him the story of an ancient king and his Brahmin chaplain who performed a purely symbolic bloodless sacrifice. Kutadanta sits in silence at the end of this narrative, having realized that the Buddha did not say, "I have heard this," and the Buddha confirms that it is a story from one of his past lives, thus technically a birth story. The Buddha then tells of sacrifice more profitable, that is the higher benefits, as in Sutta 2. Kutadanta liberates the hundreds of animals he had detained for slaughter, saying, "Let them be fed with green grass and given cool water to drink, and let cool breeze play upon them." He becomes a lay follower, and the pure and spotless Dhammai opens in him. Number 6. Mahali Sutta. About Mahali, heavenly sight, soul and body. Ottada, the Lichavi, inquires of the Buddha about why some people cannot hear heavenly sounds and so on, which Buddha explains as due to their practice of one-sided samadhi. In later part, the Buddha tells how two ascetics, Mandisa and Jaliya, had asked him whether the soul or life principle is the same as body or different? This is one of the unanswered questions mentioned in Sutta 9. The Buddha says anyone who has attained to higher states of understanding will no longer be bothered by such questions. Number 7. Jalya Sutta. About Jalya, merely repeats the last part of Sutta 6. Number 8. Mahasihanada Sutta. The great lion's roar is also called the lion's roar to Kassapa. The naked ascetic Kassapa asks if it is true that the Buddha condemns all form of austerity. The Buddha denies this, saying one must distinguish. Kassapa gives a list of standard practices, some of them rather revolting. And the Buddha says one may do any of these things, but if one's morality, heart and wisdom are not developed, one is still far from being an ascetic or Brahmin in the true sense. He himself has practiced all possible austerities to perfection and morality and wisdom as well. Kassapa requests ordination, and soon through diligent practice, he becomes an Arahant. Number 9. Potapada Sutta. About Potapada, state of consciousness. The ascetic Potapada tells the Buddha that he and his followers have been debating about the higher extinction of consciousness and seek a ruling on the matter. The Buddha says, those who think mental status arise and pass away by chance are quite wrong. He lists the various jhana states, showing how perception can be controlled. Potapada says he has never heard anything like this before. The discussion moves to various kinds of possible self, all of which the Buddha refutes, and to the unanswered questions and the reasons for their not being answered. Chitta, son of the elephant trainer, joins the discussion, and finally, while Potapada becomes a lay follower, Chitta becomes a bhikkhu and soon gains arahantship. In this sutta, we first find the parable of the man who said he was in love with the most beautiful girl in the country without knowing who she was or what she looked like. Number 10. Subha Sutta. About Subha, morality, concentration and wisdom. Shortly after the Buddha's death, Ananda explained to the Arvind morality, concentration and wisdom, as in Sutta 2, to the young Brahmin Subha who becomes a lay follower. Number 11. Kevada Sutta. About Kevada, what Brahmin didn't know. Kevada urges the Buddha to perform miracles to strengthen people's faith. The Buddha refuses, saying only kind of miracle he approves is of the miracle of instruction. He tells the story of the monk who wanted to know why the four great elements by psychic power he ascended into the heavens. But none who could tell him, not even the great Brahma, who referred him back to the Buddha for an answer. Number 12. Lohicha Sutta. About Lohicha, good and the bad teachers. Lohicha has a pernicious view of if anyone were to discover some of his doctrine, he should keep it to himself. The Buddha puts him right and explains the difference between good and bad teachers. Number 13. Tevijja Sutta. The threefold knowledge, the way to Brahma. Two young Brahmins are puzzled because different teachers speak of different ways of attaining fellowship or union with the Brahma, which to them is the highest goal. The Buddha gets them to admit that none of their teachers, or even those from whom the tradition stems, have ever seen Brahma face to face. Then instruct them in the Brahma Viharas, which do lead to the goal, which is not, of course, the goal of Buddhism. Division 2. The Great Division. Number 14. Mahapradana Sutta. The Great Discourses in the Lineage. This refers to the last seven Buddhas going back to 91 aeons in time. The life of the Buddha Vipassya, the remote period, is told in terms similar to early versions of the life of Gautama. All Buddhas go through the same experiences in their last earthly life. The Buddha's realization is equated with the understanding of dependent origination. Number 15. Mahanidana Sutta. The Great Discourse on the Origination. Ananda is rebuked for saying the law of dependent origination is as clear to him. The Buddha explains it in reverse order first, but going back only to mind and body and consciousness, and also omitting the six senses basis. The expositions end with a reference to the seven stages of consciousness and the two realms. Number 16, Mahaparinibbana Sutta. The great passing, the Buddha's last days, the longest sutta of all, telling, not without some legendary embroidery, the story of Buddha's last days. King Ajatasattu, wishing to attack the Vajjins, sends to the Buddhas to know what the outcome will be. The Buddha replies indirectly, pointing out the advantages of the Vajjin republican system, and later urges the monks to observe comparable rules for the Sangha. With Ananda, he visits a series of places and gives discourses to monks and laity. At Patli Gama, he prophesies the place's future greatness. It becomes Asoka's capital, Pataliputra. At Vaisali, the courtesan Ambapali invites him to a meal and gives a mango grove to the order. He tells Ananda that he will pass away within these 3 months. At Pava Chunda, the smith serves meals including pig's delight, Sukra Madhava, or pork truffles. Opinions are vary, which only the Buddha eats. Later he is taken very ill, but is careful to exonerate Chunda. At Kuzinara, the Buddha rests between twin salt trees. Ananda begs him not to pass away in such an insignificant place, but he says it was once a famous capital. After giving last instructions to the Sangha and refusing to appoint a successor, he utters final admonition, strive on untiringly, appamadena sampadeta, and passes away. The sutta concludes with an account of the funeral and distribution of the ashes in 8 portions. Number 17, Mahasudassana Sutta. The Great Splendor, a King's Renunciation. Much the same story recurs in Jataka 95. King Mahasudassana lived in fairy tale splendor and possessed the 7 treasures, but finally retired to his Dhamma palace built by the gods to lead a life of meditation. Number 18, Janavasabha Sutta. About Janavasabha, Brahma addresses the gods. A yaka of the gods variety appears to the Buddha, declaring that he is now called Janavasabha, but on earth was the King Bimbisara of Magadha. The Buddha's great supporter, killed by his son Ajatasattu, he tells of the assembly of the 33 gods, at which Brahma declared how, since the Buddha's mission on earth, the ranks of the gods, devas, are increasing and those of their opponents, the Asuras, declining. Number 19, Mahagovinda Sutta. The Great Steward, a past life of Gautama. The Gandharva Panchasika appears to the Buddha and reports, similarly to the Sutta 18, on a meeting of the gods. Then follows the story of the great steward who conducted the affairs of 7 kings and then retired into the homeless life, bringing many people to the Brahma world, which is the highest people can reach in an age when there is no Buddha. At the end of the Buddha tells Panchasika that he was the steward, but that the path he now teaches as the Buddha goes beyond what he was able to teach then. Number 20, Mahasamaya Sutta. The mighty greeting, devas come to see the Buddha, a sutta practically in all verse giving much mythological lore. Number 21, Sakkapanya Sutta. Sakka's questions, a god consults the Buddha. Sakka, king of 33 gods, approaches the Buddha through the aid of Panchasika, who sings a love song to him to attract his attention. Sakka puts various questions on the holy life to the Buddha. We also hear the story of the nun Gopika, who became a man and such a rebuked 3 of the Buddha's monks who had been reborn in the lowest of the heavens, bidding them strive hard and rise higher, which 2 of them succeeds in doing. Sakka himself is put on the right path and rewards Panchasika, who is not so advanced, with the hands of the Gandharva maiden he desired. Number 22, Mahasatipatthana Sutta, the great discourse on the foundations of mindfulness. Very different in character from the suttas immediately preceding, this is held by many to be the most important sutta in the canon. It recurs verbatim less verses 18 to 21 as number 10 in the Majjhima Nikaya. The one way for the purification of beings, for the overcoming of sorrow and distress, for the gaining of Nibbana is the four foundations of mindfulness. Mindfulness of body, feeling, mind and mind objects. Detailed instruction for mindful awareness of breathing and so on are given. Thus under mind objects, we read for example, if sensual desire is present in himself, a monk knows that he is present. If sensual desire is absent in himself, a monk knows that it is absent. And he knows how unarising sensual desires come to arise, and he knows how the abandonment of arising sensual desires comes about, and he knows how the non-arising of abundant sensual desires in the future will come about. Mark here, according to the commentary, means anyone who does the practice. The sutta ends with an account of the Four Noble Truths. Number 23, Payasi Sutta. About Payasi, debate with a skeptic. Prince Payasi does not believe in future lives or in the rewards and penalties of goods and bad deeds. The Venerable Kumar of Kasapa convinced him of his error by means of a series of clever parables. Finally, Payasi, converted, establishes a charity for ascetics and needy, but does so broodingly. As a result, he is reborn in the lowest of the heavens. Division 3, the Patika Division. 24, Patika Sutta. About Patika Putta, the charlatan. The Buddha has an exceedingly stupid desire for Sunakata, who even truly leaves him. Sunakata is greatly impressed by some dubious holy men whom he takes to be arahant. The boastful naked ascetic Patika Putta challenges the Buddha to a contest of miracles. The Buddha waits for him to appear. As the Buddha prophesied, he cannot even rise from his seat to meet the Buddha. The sutta is not unamusing but definitely substandard material. A final section of the origin of things seems to have been tacked on. Number 25, Udumbarika Singhanatha Sutta. The lion's roar to the Udumbarikans. The wanderer Nigoda, staying at the Udumbarika lodging, boasts that he can floor the ascetic Gautama with a single question. He is of course defeated, and the Buddha shows a way beyond that of a self-mortification to reach the pit. 26. Chakravarti Sihanada Sutta. The lion's roar on the turning of the wheel. At the beginning and the end of the discourse, the Buddha exhorts his monks to keep to their own preserves by the practice of mindfulness. Then he tells of the wheel-turning monarch, a righteous ruler, who had the scared wheel pressure, which had to be carefully guarded. He was followed by a line of righteous kings, but eventually they degenerated, and society went from bad to worse. While the human lifespan sank 10 years and all sense of morality was lost, after a brief but dreadful sword intervals, things improved, and the final end of the Buddha, Maitreya, will appear. Number 27, Agganya Sutta. On knowledge of beginnings, a somewhat similar fable, this time addressed to the Brahmins, whose pretensions the Buddha refutes. There is no difference between Brahmins and others if they behave badly. A somewhat fanciful account of the origin of caste is given. Number 28, Sampasadaniya Sutta. So in faith, Sariputta explains his reasons for his complete faith in the Buddha. Number 29, Pasadika Sutta, the delightful discourse. A discussion of good and bad teachers and why the Buddha has not revealed certain points. Number 30, Lakkhana Sutta, the marks of a great man. verses on the curious 32 marks of a great man, beloved of the Brahmins. These are in a variety of meters in the original. Number 31, Singhalaka Sutta, to Singhalaka, advice to lay people, advice to the young layman Singhalaka on morality related to the four quarters, Zenith and Nadir, which in memory of his father he had been worshipping. 32, Atanatya Sutta, the Atanata protective verses. Number 33, Sangeeti Sutta, the chanting together, lists of term for recitation. Number 34, Dasuttara Sutta, expanding decades, similar material to Sutta 33, arranged under 10 heads.